your seats at the back there? If the people who are standing, can you have seats? Good evening and welcome to the planning committee. My name is Councillor Anita Leach and I am the chair of the committee. My role this evening is to ensure that the committee runs smoothly, having regard to procedure, behaviour and ethics. To explain who the rest of the people on the tables here tonight are, to my immediate right is the council solicitor, who will give advice to the committee on any procedural or legal matters that might arise. To my left are the council's planning officers, highway engineer and environmental health officer, who will present the application this evening and give any technical advice to the committee which may be sought. The rest of the people you see down both sides of the tables are the elected members, who will consider the application this evening and make the decisions. Before each application is considered, there will be a short presentation by the planning officers. In the event that an application has received a qualifying petition signed by 25 signatures or more, one representative of the petition will be invited to address the committee in support of the petition for up to 5 minutes. If a petitioner addresses the committee, then the applicant or their agent will be invited to make representations to the committee in support of their application, again for up to 5 minutes. However, if a petitioner has not addressed the committee, then the applicant or their agent will not be invited to make any representations. A ward councillor can address the committee in relation to an application. The ward councillor may speak on behalf of the resident. However, once the ward councillor has returned to the public gallery, they will not return to take part in any debate that might follow between the committee. The application will then be open to debate and discussion by members of the planning committee, who will then make a decision on, the application. If a site visit is requested and approved by the committee, then this matter will not be discussed this evening and will be discussed as a subsequent planning meeting. Members, you have an amended version of the minutes. Are we happy to approve those amended versions of the minutes?
Yes, thank you, Chair.
And everybody's clear on what the amendments are?
Yes.
Thank you. Are there any declarations of interest? Chris?
I'd like to declare an interest on item number 9. I know the applicant's personal. Thank you.
Ian?
A declaration of interest on item 5, in that I'm a member of a working group established by the Cabinet of Housing to deal with houses and multiple occupations.
Thank you.
Can I just clarify whether you'll be leaving?
Yes, I'll be leaving.
Okay, are there any requests for site visits? Chris?
Can I request a site visit for item number 4, please? There's an eligible correspondence from concerned residents.
Have you any others?
Yes, through you, Chair. I'd like to ask for a site visit on agenda item 14, 277 Road. I think it'd be informative, though, to the committee, to see on the ground the impact and the implications of the housing residents on this development.
Yes, thank you, Chair. Request a site visit for item 13, Mill Lane, Greasley. There's really need to see on site.
Thank you. Thank you, Chair. I'd like to request a site visit on item 11, in view of the fact that the appeal has been dismissed, but that the mass footprint of this particular development has not been altered, and it is in the conservation area. So I'd be particularly interested to see the impact of this application on that side.
Yeah, item 7, Cleveland Street, Burton Head, that's a major development with the potential
has had significant impacts on residents nearby, so I think the committee would benefit from the site visit.
Okay,
are
you all right?
Okay, members happy to approve all of those site visits? Okay, for members of the public who are here this evening, as I said, we've only discussed these items this evening, so you're happy to, I'm happy for you to leave if you so wish. So it's agenda item 4, which is 26 Cornelius Drive. It's agenda item 7, which is Law Street and Cleveland Street. Agenda item 11, Land North of Old Croft, Barnard Lane. Agenda item 13, Thornhill Lane, Greensby. And agenda item 14, 277 Telegraph Road. I've also been made aware of the fact that agenda item 8, 3-5 Token Street, has been withdrawn from tonight's agenda. So anybody that's here for any of those matters, I'm happy to leave now. Site visits will be on the 20th of March. For members of the public that are now sitting in the very back, if you want to come forward, please feel free to do so. I might hear a little bit better. Okay, so the first item that we're going to look at this evening is agenda item 5, LME's discount at 186 Borough Road, Seaford. Could we have a presentation, please?
Thank you, Chair, through you, Chair. This application has been taken out of delegation by Councillors Stewart, Chris Jones and Adrian Jones, as they have strong reservations regarding the intensification of HMOs in the area and overcrowding. The proposed development comprises of a change of use of the first and second floor of the building to 5 bedsits and associated kitchen diner at ground floor level. The ground floor retail use will be retained. The application site is located in a traditional suburban centre and comprises of a retail unit at ground floor level with residential accommodation above. Properties within a block of 7 existing units. With regards to local plan policy, the application has been assessed against UTP policy HS14. However, current national and planning, local planning policies do not contain advice on minimum room sizes. The Council's Housing Standards team confirm that there is no objection proposed in terms of licensing the proposed use, and the premises will be subject to alterations for the ground floor in terms of the internal layout of the kitchen dining room. In terms of the extent of external alterations, these include the provision of an additional door and window at ground floor level. It's considered that this proposal meets the requirements of UTP policy HS14 and is therefore recommended for approval subject to the attached conditions.
Thank you. Is there anyone in council would like to speak on this? Would you like to come forward, please?
My name is Councillor Adrian Jones.
Okay, and there's a microphone, please switch on the
Councillor Jones. Okay, here you go.
Yep.
Okay. Well, Chair, officers, members of the committee, I'm here to speak for the a number of residents of the locality who expressed some concern to me, including a neighbouring businessman. This part of Wirral is very rapidly having its character changed through the high incidence of conversions of this sort and similar. There are several other empty shops close to this one, and local residents have already spoken to me about what they regard as the Packamin and Pylon High type of private development that's overtaking family homes as well as businesses to the detriment of the neighbourhood. I regret to say, Chair and members, that there's a very real fear among residents that where developments are allowed, that seek to squeeze the maximum income out of buildings by pressing the maximum number of people into small spaces, then it's a form of overcrowding. And I hate to think that this council might be remembered by our children for giving permission today for the development of tomorrow's rundown areas and human being slums. The building in question is a former shop of the sort that was designed for business use with family accommodation above, and there is sufficient room for family accommodation. I was a student for 5 years, most of the time living in multi-occupancy houses. I never saw anything as crowded as this, even in the pretty poor accommodation that students had to put up with in the 1960s. Even by those standards, this would have been regarded as extremely poor. Former, relatively small double-sized rooms have been reduced in this house to make 5 single rooms, with parts even of the already limited space reduced further by the necessity to have communal lavatories and showers on each of the 2 floors. The already small rooms have been further reduced in their airspace by the installation of suspended ceilings, thereby obviously making each room, I would suggest, a little bit difficult to be very comfortable in. There's only a narrow staircase from the ground floor to the first and second floors. I did manage it, but not without a great deal of difficulty, and even the people with upsticks, I think, were struggling a bit. When I visited, there was no rail at either end of the stairs towards the top. I saw no provision for external fire escapes. I believe that a fire on the ground or middle floor would, certainly in my opinion, leave those in the rooms above trapped, unless they were prepared to jump out of windows. There's no sitting or dining room on either floor. To find a sitting or dining room, the residents from the first and top floor have to walk all the way down to the ground floor, where there's a smallish room situated behind the shop, between the shop and the outside yard. If only 5 people wanted to use the communal room together, they wouldn't have much room. But with 5 bedrooms, I think there's a real scope of possibility of more than 5 people at any one time being there. And of course, there are only 2 lavatories. So all in all, Chair and members of the committee, I think that this is a very unfortunate development that really ought not to be pursued. I wouldn't be against the place being used for perhaps 2 flats, but 5 bed sitting rooms in that sort of circumstance, in my opinion, is overcrowding of the kind that we don't want.
Thank you very much.
Before I make any comments, can we just confirm, can the officers confirm confirm who the applicant is, because the paperwork refers to Mr. Allen. When we visited the site, there was notification attached to various parts of the building where it said it was Rivergate. Now, Rivergate, as we know, as we understand, is controlled by a serving member. Can we have some confirmation, please? Just to reiterate really what the other members have said, and certainly what the Board Councillor has said, we have had in recent months a number of HMOs before us. Everyone that we've visited has been, for want of a better word, a glorified DOS house. This one's no exception. I don't believe that any application we receive, my first test is would the applicant want to live there? I don't believe the applicant would want to live in this property. If the applicant doesn't want to live in this property, why should we expect any resident of this borough to live in this property? It is exploitation, as far as I'm concerned, of those who are least able to defend themselves, who are forced into this kind of accommodation, put at risk through fire risk, overcrowding, insanitary conditions, in an area that, as Councillor Jones has made clear, is already under pressure. By approving this application, we would be increasing that pressure on that particular community, that part of Wallasey. I think that would be a retrograde step for this authority, and I would be certainly happy to support refusal of this application. But I would like some clarification as to who the applicant is, please.
The applicant is Mr. Ale. He signed certificates and he owns it. And the Rivergate, the company that drew up the plans for the submission to the planning department.
Right, okay. Thank you.
Okay, are there any other comments? Okay, should we go back to you then, Pat, to hear your reasons for refusal?
Yeah, thank you, Chair. It's having regards to the number of bedrooms proposed. Property is considered. Considered to be of insufficient size to accommodate the proposed development. The development would result in an over-intensive use of the property by creating 5 bedrooms, for which, given the potential number of occupants, the proposed kitchen, stroke dining, stroke lounge facilities, is considered to be inadequate, resulting in a standard of accommodation that the council considers would be substandard, contrary to the objectives of policy HS14, that's policy HS14 of the World Unitary Development Plan, and the principles of the National Planning Policy Framework, which seeks to secure a high quality accommodation and a good standard of amenity for all future occupants of land and buildings.
Okay, so we've got Pat Hackett has moved that, and Denise Rowan is seconded. All those in favour of refusal? That's unanimous. That's... So, moving now on to agenda item 6, the ship in 208 Brett Road, which is page 25. Thank you, Chair. Through you, Chair. This application has been referred to the Planning Committee as there is a qualifying petition and 11 separate letters of objection. The application was also deferred from the last Planning Committee in order for members to visit the site. The application is for the construction of 9 dwellings in 3 blocks of 3. The design is contemporary and the properties have front balconies of 2nd floor level. Due to the topography of the site, development appears as 3-storey at the front and 2-storey at the rear. The site is split into 2 distinct sections, the former car park to the pub, and a small copse of trees. The site is within a designated primary residential area, and the rect to the south of the site is designated as the Melbourne Green Space. The whole of the application site is within an area designated for primary residential. The application has been assessed against UDP policy HS4. The copse of trees have the potential to provide habitat for protected species, and the applicants have submitted a habitat survey that suggests there's no detriment to these protected species, and this has been verified by World Wildlife. In relation to the separation distances, the proposed development will be located 23 metres from North Major Court to the rear of the site, and given the changes in level between the two sites, the residents of North Major Court will maintain an outlook over the roof of the proposed houses.
Properties on the other side of Breck Road, directly facing the site, will be located 33 metres away from the proposed dwellings. In terms of highway implications, there are no objections on highway grounds in relation to the parking, highway safety or capacity. The access site is steep and conditions have been attached to ensure that the crossfall, footway and vehicle crossing should be no steeper than 1 in 40. It's considered that sighting design and external appearance of proposed dwellings are acceptable and will not impact on the visual character of the area. The required interface distance can be achieved to ensure that there is no detrimental impact on the residential communities that surrounding occupies. For these reasons, the application is recommended for approval subject to the attached conditions.
Thank you very much. We do have a qualified petition on this. Is the lead petitioner here to speak on this? Could I ask you to state your name and address and how to 5 minutes to speak? There is a button at the bottom I can press.
Sure.
Yeah, I'll let you know when we've got 1 minute left.
Okay. Right. Ladies and gentlemen, committee, my main objection.
Can I just ask you to state your name and address?
Oh, yeah, it's 213 Breck Road. I live opposite the proposed site.
John Ross.
Yeah, my main objection is these nine dwellings, the road coming out onto Breck Road. It comes out onto a bottleneck in Breck Road. Now, it's always been a dangerous area, that. You've got three schools around. You've got Mosslands, Weatherhead, and St. Mary's. So, in the peak time, you've got quite a lot of traffic and people from the different schools. Now, there's been three people knocked down just where the site is in the past that I know of. And one was my daughter, and also the next door neighbour, he was knocked down, and they were in hospital for a good time. And in 205 opposite, the young lad was knocked down and killed him, you know. So I consider this road coming out onto the bottleneck is just going to be disastrous. I think the planning committee, the council and the highways should look very carefully at this, because that could be an accident waiting to happen. Now, there were other objections, but they didn't get in mind, so they've got their reason. But that's my reason. And also, you must be saving wildlife there as well. So that's all I have to say.
Okay, thank you very much.
Mr. Bottom.
Yes. Thank you very much. Is the applicant here? Would you like to come forward to speak? Okay, again, if I could just ask you to state the name.
Is this on?
You need to press the button at the bottom. So ask you to state your name. You have 5 minutes. I'll let you know you have a minute left.
My name is Tom Partridge. I'm from MCI's regulations for this project. As the planning officer stated, this is a prime location for housing. It is a steep site. It's overgrown with shrubs and sapling trees. And our ecology report shows that, biodiversity report shows that it's mostly self-seeded trees and poor quality. Though we are planning to plant new stock to planting across the site, and also retain high quality trees along the frontage. The proposed houses have been designed to work with the gradients rather than against the site, and have split floor levels. As stated, the rear of the house is half a storey high in front. This reduces the need for excavation and optimises the topography of the site. Whilst we recognise some of the objections and concerns relating to overlooking, we are well in excess of the council's own guidelines. And for some context and clarity, similar local roads, the overlooking distance is about 21 metres on local roads. Wall Acre Road is 21 metres, Hillside Road is 22 metres, and back-to-back houses are generally about 15 metres apart. Whereas we're proposing 23 metres at the closest point, going up to 33 metres for blocks B and C, which are set further back into the site. The site is highly sustainable. We've got only one car parking space per house. Though in discussion with the planners, even this could have been reduced to no parking because we've got within walking distance of the train station, there's a bus stop right in front of the site. We're walking distance of schools, shops, doctors, hospitals. Having worked closely with the highways department, we have spent a lot of time looking at the access to the site, the visibility displays, and we're proposing to increase the width of the pavement in front of the site by 2 metres. This should help alleviate current concerns with traffic because it'll enable safer pedestrian access along Grant Road. Should be a benefit in terms of access. And to be belts and braces, we also accepted that there will be a condition to iron out the details of the access. As mentioned, the contemporary style of the houses is designed to mediate between the modernist flats which are at the top of the hill on Milkway Court and the more traditional style semi-detached houses which are on Grant Road. So we have a traditional form of pitch roof townhouses whilst having large glazed openings for windows and doors, and more contemporary materials such as timber cladding and trees. We believe that we've produced a sustainable design solution which is productive use of this otherwise uncapped land. Thank you. We hope that you support the officer's recommendation.
Thank you for the time. Could you just turn on the microphone?
Yeah.
Is there a wrong councillor here to speak on this? No. Okay, can I open this up to committee? David?
Before I say anything, could we just have a look at the plans that we can get an insight into what the site actually involves? Plans of the site. Again, it was another very valuable site visit on Tuesday, and it gave us the context of what was being proposed. My only concern and issue was what was raised by one of the objectors. The objector was the access in terms of sight lines from the existing road and what impact this development would have on traffic congestion on that road. I thought the development itself looked quite nice, but if you could just explain to us exactly where we are and show us where the access point will be to the site, I think it would just help those who weren't able to go on the site maybe to gain an appreciation of what we're looking at.
Thank you. The access to the site is where the
thank you. The access to the site is where the plan was being looked at now. The hard surface area is the car parking area at the front, blocks B and C are set further back in block A. There's a small area of landscaping that trees to be provided both at the front and in the rear of the site.
Thank you.
And the increased width of paving, can you just indicate where that would be shown on there, please?
Through you, Chair, so the length of footway that we've come to an agreement can be widened to 2 metres is in front of the northernmost block of three, which are at ground level, so it's the three that have been built in the car park. That's showing a narrow footway there, which is the current situation, but what we'll be looking at is a 2 metre footway there, which will help to provide better sidelines for traffic coming out of those accesses, and also the traffic coming out of the shared access for the six elevated properties at the back of the site.
Thank you.
And I think just in terms of, Keith, while you've got the microphone, sorry, you nearly lost it. Just in terms of some of the comments that were raised by Mr. Wright regarding the fact that there have been a number of accidents within the area, can you just talk us through that, please?
I think in terms of the sort of traffic that this is going to generate, when you look at the previous use of the site and the fact that there was a car park there, this is utilising, or the shared parking space is utilising the same access as the car park. I don't think this is going to create any significant additional traffic on this road compared to the previous uses, and also compared to the volume of traffic that already uses this road. And as I say, the visibility there from the accesses is acceptable to in terms of road safety. So I think in terms of the risk that's involved in this proposal, I don't see any additional highway safety grounds to object to this proposal.
Are we aware of whether just the accidents that were reported by Mr. Wright, is that all of the accidents that have happened in that area, or do we know if there are any reports?
I don't have the details of any of those particular accidents. It could be that they've fallen off the record. We only go back, we look back 3 years,
okay.
Because that's where traffic conditions change so much over the years, and the intervention measures that we put in place to improve road safety, both locally and nationally, improve those figures, so we don't go back further than 3 years. So there may be accidents from previous years, but there's nothing there at the moment.
Thank you. Ian?
Thank you, Joe. I'm a bit concerned, to be honest, in terms of the vehicle access. I hear what the traffic officer said, but we know that from the site visits, and thank you to the committee for agreeing to the site visit at the last meeting, but when you come south from St Hilary Brow, there is a blind spot caused by the location of the pub at the moment, in that you can't, if you're trying to come out of what is currently the pub car park, it is difficult to see traffic coming to your right, coming down. I'm concerned that the particular layout of Block A on this design has three vehicle access points coming out past the pub, where, in spite of the fact that the footway in front is now 2 metres, it doesn't alter the fact that the pub on your right is still blocking visibility from traffic coming round from south, from St Hilary Brow. Particularly at school times, Mr Wright mentioned there are three schools, that this is a particular blocking at school times because of the location of Weatherhead High School, where, you know, we did, sound like an old man, but when Weatherhead School was first proposed, we did raise concerns about traffic on this road, because of the nature and the width of the road and the poor visibility. Now, at school times, traffic is almost impossible at St Hilary Brow because of the problems caused by the volume of traffic. I'm not sure that cars trying to get in and out of Block A at peak time are going to be either able to get out or to get out safely with the impact on other road users. And the applicants did mention some mitigating factors. Can the highways officer tell us what mitigating factors have been made, apart from the fact we have a 2 metre footpath in front? Is there any other measures proposed?
No, it's the 2 metre footway and some alterations to the levels of the car park on the raised dwellings, so that the ramp coming down wasn't as steep, it wouldn't be as steep on this as it would have originally been. And so it is basically the 2 metre footway, and that provides better visibility for traffic, for drivers emerging from their driveways. It creates the necessary there's an display between that drive and the pedestrian on the footway, and it will help actually merging onto the road itself, or some sort of visibility between that and the traffic on the road.
Thank you, Keith. Trina?
Yeah,
so
I'm really sorry to hear about the accident with Mr. Wright's daughter and his neighbour. I mean, can the highway officer just say, is this absolutely all, you know, that you can put in place in regards to health and safety, you know, road safety conditions, just by extending the footpath way to 2 metres? Is there nothing else that was in the committee could put in place, you know, to improve these conditions? Anything else?
Not really, Chair. No, I think, talk about traffic calming, it's a classified road, it's a major strategic route, it's a fire route, so we couldn't traffic calm it. And there are other accesses along this road that have limited visibility when they're emerging. The thing with individual private accesses is the risk factor. I do understand members' concerns, but the risk factor involved with a single private access is extremely low. So the chance of an accident occurring related to any private access, regardless of how poor the visibility is extremely low. So I'm comfortable that these three individual accesses there, and that the combined access for the six elevated properties are sufficient and suitable for this road at this location.
Okay, anybody else?
Pat? Just briefly, Chair, on the same subject, where it says on page 30 in highway traffic implications, because I do know this area really well, and I agree with Councillor that it is a bottleneck around there. We've got the Bradford and London roundabout, and it's absolutely mad busy there. That school town, the schools are going in and coming out. Without a doubt. But it says here, due to the changes in the level of the site and the adjoining highway, the access road into the site that has been proposed by the architect is very steep and as such deemed unsuitable. And I know Keith has said here about, and you just mentioned it, about a number of issues to remedy that, but it could argue that the land itself is unstable. And I'm not clear exactly. Maybe you can tell us exactly, just maybe the people you've said before, the measures you're going to take to address that. And just lastly as well, I mean, again, with what I just said at the outset, I can't get my head around. You're coming out of that car park there and you're looking to the right. If that's coming out, that extra bit, yeah, it's quite a bit that it's not going to narrow that road, and it is that mad business, you don't know how you look at it. And surely that's a danger. I understand what you're saying, but you know, I can't understand. You're coming out of that car park and you're looking to your right in what is a busy road to get those times. The schools are going in and out. Surely that's going to impinge on safety.
Are you asking for clarification of whether the pathway is going to come out onto the road or whether it's coming back into the land?
Yeah, and also the comments in here where it's as such deemed unsuitable.
Okay,
thank you, through you, Chair. Yeah, the additional width is taken from within the site, so it doesn't encroach further out into the highway. The proposed access is in the same location as the existing access, so if anything, moving the footway back so we've got 2 metres would improve the visibility from the existing access compared to what's proposed. The wording of that comment on page 30 that you referred to, when the application was first submitted, it was unsuitable, it was too steep, but we've had considerable discussions with the applicant, both myself and our highway asset manager, and we've come to a situation where although the houses are in the same location, the level of the car park would be reduced so that we would have a ramp that's within acceptable acceptable tolerances. And then when it comes out onto the footway, it's as it says there, it could be 140 crosswalk, which is our standard crosswalk for footway. So I guess that really should say, and as submitted was deemed unsuitable, but since then, we've had these discussions. It is conditioned within the couple of the conditions, the suggested conditions, condition 9, which would give us control over these details, so that they'll have to be submitted prior to construction. We'd have to approve them, and then they'd have to be constructed in accordance with those approved details. Does that help, Chair?
Yes, I think it's certainly positive for me. Is anybody else? Are you happy with the clarification for that? Okay, Ian?
Can I just while I was sticking with Keith, while you've got the microphone. The application is to change the pub as well into a single story, sorry, into a dwelling house. Where is the car parking for the pub that becomes a dwelling house?
On the original proposal for the pub, there was, it did include an access on the far side of the pub where there's a very, very narrow arrangement. I wasn't satisfied with that, so that was taken out, and the pub itself will have no off street parking.
I'm sorry to load this one together. This pub is quite a large building. To be turned into a single dwelling house, it's safe to assume it's going to be a family home. It would be safe to assume that there will be vehicles associated with this family home. There's no parking anywhere for vehicles either visiting that home or people living there. That's what we're saying on this application. Is that right?
Sorry, Chair, that was a different application which had been approved previously.
Right.
So that's not this application.
Yeah.
It is a sustainable location in terms of access to local amenities, local services, local shops and bus routes, and the train station is within a reasonable distance. So, there are people who don't have cars or don't have access to cars, for them this could be an ideal location. Further along the road from here where it widens out, there are areas where people park. There's usually somewhere to park along there. If someone did have a car, or obviously we have to walk distance. Somebody looking to purchase that house, obviously we have to take that into consideration. If it was an important factor to them to have a car close to the house, then that's a consideration.
Yeah. Sorry, Chair, I was making the point of the impact of the two applications, although looking at each on their own merits. We've already approved one where there is no parking for a family home, and now we're potentially approving 9 further properties where there is parking. I'm concerned about the impact on the traffic on this particular stretch of Brett Road. That's the point.
Yeah, I think you made the point really about the fact that you are concerned about the traffic, as a number of other members have. Obviously, that was a separate application which has been approved, it's been approved, and we're mindful of the fact that it's been approved, and we've now got another application before us, which we can just view and answer. Okay, is there anybody else who wants to speak on this? Okay, well, the officer's recommendation is to approve this subject to the conditions listed. Do we have a mover for this, please? Denise, do we have a seconder? Kathy? All those in favour of approval? Those against? Okay, that's carried. Kind of 10-3. Thank you.
Thank you.